There are many types of conflict in the workplace that you will need to deal with, but by far the most frequent and most challenging are personality conflicts. However, there are four other ways conflicts arise at work that are worthy of mentioning before we take a more in-depth look at one of the ways you can minimise the negative impact of personality clashes. The first one is interdependence conflicts. These types of conflicts happen when a person relies on someone else's cooperation, output, or input for them to get their job done. For example, a salesperson is always late inputting the monthly sales figures. This causes the accountant to be late with her reports. Interdependence conflicts can be overcome by ensuring that 1. People have a good handle on delegation skills, and yes, you can delegate across, up, and not just down. Secondly, that people are well trained in how to have challenging conversations. And third, that consequences, natural and imposed, are used. For example, the salesperson who is late with his or her input could have a bonus reduction, which is an imposed consequence. Use the link below to take the delegation quiz to test your capability at delegating. Then, if you find you need to fine-tune your skills in this area, access the How to Delegate So You Get It Done, Done Well, and Done on Time program. Delegation is one of the skills that all high-performance rockstar leaders master. The second type of conflict that we can look at is differences in styles. Conflict often happens because people have differing preferences on how to get things done. For example, one person may want to get the work done quickly, that is, they're a task-oriented type person, and get on to the next thing as fast as possible, while another person is more concerned about making sure that everyone has a say in how the work gets done. They're a more people-oriented person. You can hose down a lot of potential conflicts when you're trained in how to understand and successfully navigate your way through style differences. And make no mistake, style differences generally lead to personality conflicts. In fact, here's an example of a style conflict that was fast looking like a personality conflict. I was recently coaching a client who was complaining about a colleague who'd taken 5 minutes to run his eyes over her report that she'd spent way more than 20 hours compiling, and then he immediately started pointing out to her the things that she hadn't got quite right. Boy, was she angry. She said to me, "How dare he glance over it for 5 minutes and then provide an opinion on it? He hardly has enough background to make such broad sweeping judgment. He's impossible. I'm going to have to tell my boss that I just cannot work with him." After hearing this, I reminded her of the DISC webinar she'd recently attended with me, and she got it straight away that this was a style conflict. Her preferred style, which is steadiness, is to take time to think things through before making a well-considered comment and or decision. Whereas his preferred style, which is dominating, means he makes fast decisions and offers opinions freely. Once we'd taken it back to differences in style, she saw a way to discuss with him his responses to her work. But more importantly, how they could use each other's styles to work more effectively together. So the third type of conflict in the workplace that I want to talk about is differences in background and gender. Conflicts can arise between people because of differences in age, educational backgrounds, personal experiences, ethnic heritage, gender, and political preferences. In the link below, there's an interview I did with Barbara Annis on gender diversity and inclusiveness. There are some great tips in the interview to help you make the most of gender differences. Fourth type of conflict that we often see before we get into the personality clashes is differences in leadership style. Now, leaders have different ways of leading their teams, and team members who have to deal with various leaders throughout a day can become confused and irritated by these different ways of being led. For example, one leader may be more open and inclusive, while another may be more directive. To avoid this type of disruption, make sure that your leadership team puts together a robust set of principles and values. Then, most importantly, they use them to provide consistency in how they make decisions and involve people in the business. Okay, so let's turn our attention to personality clashes. These personality clashes are often the biggest cause of conflict in the workplace. They're often ignited by emotions and perceptions about somebody else's motives and character. For example, a team leader jumps on someone for being late because she views the team member as being lazy and disrespectful, whereas the team member sees the team leader as out to get him because he isn't one of the favoured children. I put that in inverted quotes. So how do you handle personality clashes? Well, here is possibly one of the most essential principles to follow. If you want to resolve any personality conflict successfully, you must identify the story you've got going on. Now, there are 7 principles that we teach in the Successful Feedback Program to help people resolve workplace conflict. And we don't have time to look at all 7, so we're just going to focus on this first one, which is identifying the story you've got going on. So there's 2 types of stories you can tell yourself. One story puts a figurative halo over your head and enables you to justify to yourself why you have behaved poorly and makes you look like the innocent or injured party. The second type of story is one you tell yourself about others. This story causes you to place figurative devil horns on the heads of others. You begin to negatively label them. This puts you in a downward spiral of ill feeling and lousy temper towards them. So I wanted to give you a few examples that helps you to understand what this might look like. So the first one is the situation is someone lets you down and it's not the first time. So the story you tell yourself is, God, they're irresponsible and unreliable. However, if you let someone down and it's not the first time, the story you tell yourself is, it's because I'm overworked. Can you see how in the first scenario where someone else lets you down and it's not the first time, you label and blame, whereas in the second scenario where it's you letting someone else down and it's not the first time, you justify it? Well, let's have a look at a few more examples. Someone cuts you off while driving. The story you tell yourself, they are rude, aggressive, and inconsiderate. You cut someone off while you're driving. It's because I'm in a hurry, and if I don't catch these lights, I'll miss my doctor's appointment. What about this scenario? One of your peers, whom you don't like, buys the boss a birthday card. The story you tell yourself, it's because they are soft soaping the boss and trying to weasel the way in for a promotion. When you buy your boss a birthday card, it's because I'm warm and caring. Someone flies into a rage at the post office clerk. The story you tell, they're bad tempered. When you fly into a rage at the post office clerk, the story you tell is, it's because I'm tired and this is the third time I've been here trying to resolve the problem. The post office keeps making the same mistake, which is costing me money. Now here's the important thing to underscore. Sometimes your stories are accurate, but more often than not, they are either inaccurate or incomplete or just completely wrong. The truth is often somewhere in between the story you've told yourself about why the other person is acting that way and the facts. Identifying your story is vital for 3 reasons. First, it ensures you don't overreact to a situation. Second, you open yourself up to the possibility of holding a healthy discussion rather than ambushing the other person with your emotions. And third, you begin to sift fact from story. So here's an exercise I suggest you use to start to sift story from fact. I want you to think of a conflict you have with someone at the moment. Then grab a piece of paper and draw a line down the middle of the page. In the left-hand column, write down all the stories you're telling yourself about the person, all the feelings, thoughts, judgments, labels, and conclusions that are running through your head. In the right-hand column, write down all the facts. Now, facts are observable, objective, and have specific actions and information. To differentiate between fact and story, keep this example in mind. The sky is blue is a fact. The sky is a beautiful colour is a story. So just as an example, let's say you don't like your boss. All right, so the story you're telling yourself is she's rude, she doesn't value my opinion, I don't trust her, she's got a hidden agenda, she doesn't value what I do, she'd sell me up the river in a heartbeat, and it's not my job to try and find out why she doesn't like me, she's the boss. Okay, so what are we going to look at in terms of facts on the right-hand side? Well, she doesn't acknowledge me when she walks past my desk. I haven't had any one-on-ones with her in the past month. Her diary is very full. She is being asked to juggle a lot of balls by senior management. And she has attended meetings I've run and asked detailed and insightful questions about the work we are doing. As you look at your list, you may find that the story you have been telling yourself is not fully supported by all the facts, that you have made many assumptions and interpretations about what the other person's behaviour might mean. In the link below the video, I've given you a link to the Fair Grid, which is a great tool to help you identify when you're making assumptions. Once you've sifted fact from story, next, write down how your reactions, your actions or inactions, might have contributed to the situation. This exercise is not designed to stop you from talking with the other person about the problems you're having with him or her. Its purpose is to help you wash down any overheated emotions you may have running riot through your body, to help you become a bit more objective about the situation. Then you'll be more likely to hold the conversation with less accusation and more curiosity. And I'm always recommending to my clients to come from a place of curiosity. Have you ever heard the saying, we judge others by their actions, but ourselves by our intentions? You don't honestly know what the other person's intentions are without asking. In the successful feedback training, you learn that your number one goal in any type of conflict is to discover the truth. Identifying your story is one positive step in enabling you to achieve this goal. And here's why being top-notch at handling the different types of conflict in the workplace is important. Because, look, no matter the types of conflict, ignoring them and hoping they will go away is going to cost you, possibly cost you quite dearly. If you're a leader in the business, it is going to cost you in terms of wasted time listening to people's complaints, you complaining to others about how tough you've got it, which, you know, no leader worth his or her salt should ever do. Lost productivity as people spend more time worrying about the conflict than the organizational goals. Higher absenteeism, more health claims, people withdrawing emotionally, higher employee turnover, aggression, and at times even violence. And if you're involved in the conflict, you may feel emotions like discontent, miserableness, distress, frustration, and resentment. And moreover, here's why that's so significant to you. Generally, most people are not good at leaving these feelings at work at quitting time. They trundle along home with that tension and frustration. And as you and I both know, this often causes conflict and pressure on the home front as well. So in summary, is it a luxury to spend money teaching people how to resolve conflict? Absolutely not. High-performance organizations are very aware of the need to train people in the so-called soft skills. They spend significant portions of their budget on developing people's social skills. When you and your people learn and master the skills to deal with any type of conflict in the workplace, you will be far happier and far more productive. The beautiful thing is that this type of training is a gift that keeps on giving, not only in the workplace, but into the wider community. Sadly, most people never learn the art of resolving differences and turning them into effective conversations. This can trap them in a life of angst, negativity, and bitterness. And I'm sure you want more for yourself and your team than that. We've been helping organizations shift from performing to high performing for over 18 years. So if you want to move from surviving to being seen as rock stars of your industry, then use the link below to explore the various options to work more deeply with us. Our mission is simply about helping you and your team to live, love, and lead remarkably. But if you're on a tight budget and you want to integrate a depth with your leadership training, then visit my.makeadentleadership.com to discover the benefits of becoming a member of the Make a Dent Leadership Club. And while there, make sure you sign up for the free training, Mindset of a High Performance Employee. Mindset of a High Performance Employee is a cornerstone training of all the other training we do at Make a Dent Leadership. So this is Shelley saying goodbye for now until we come together again to inspire you to live, love, and lead remarkably like a rock star leader. See you soon.